Okay, hi everybody. My name is Erin, and I'm going to be talking to you about chromosome-wide divergence underlying local adaptation along the environmental climb in Atlantic silversides. So, theory as well as empirical evidence tells us that genomic architecture determines how gene flow affects local adaptation. And under gene flow, recombination will dissociate adaptive associations between alleles. So in this figure on the left, we have, or on the right, we have gene flow from this green population into a locally adapted pink population. And over time, recombination will break down the associations between these locally adapted pink alleles, especially when the loci are not tightly linked. This association of adaptive alleles may be reduced in recombination with cold spots, for example, under the centromere, or when you have chromosomal rearrangements that suppress recombination, such as inversions, or if you have epigenetic modifications. So conversely, gene flow and local adaptation can also themselves shape genomic architecture. And so what I'm showing here on the right is a simulation study simulating the distance between selected loci over time under varying intensities of migration. And these tight associations between adaptive loci evolve rapidly under high migration, but more slowly under low migration. So silversides are a really nice system that we can use to explore genomic patterns underlying local adaptation under gene flow. Atlantic silversides are distributed along the West Atlantic coast from Florida all the way up to the Gulf of St. Lawrence. And this distribution spans one of the steepest thermal gradients in the world. So right here on the right is sea surface temperature downloaded just a few days ago. And you can see that this range spans about 30 degrees Celsius. So local adaptation to this gradient has been well documented through decades of really careful research in common garden experiments showing local adaptation in traits like growth rate, vertebral count, and temperature-dependent sex determination that are correlated with latitude. And one interesting thing is, like in traits such as growth, this local adaptation can actually be cryptic. So if you were to go out and sample adult silversides from the northern and southern parts of their range and measure them, they would be about the same length. But if you bring their offspring into the lab and grow them, then the northern individuals end up being much larger than the southern. So previous studies, as well as some preliminary data from demographic modeling, suggest that gene flow is heterogeneous across the climb. So the southern coastline between Florida all the way up to Massachusetts is pretty well connected and probably has relatively high rates of gene flow, but complex coastlines partially isolate the Gulf of Maine from the Gulf of St. Lawrence. So this sets up some interesting heterogeneity across this adaptive climb. And it creates a unique opportunity for us to understand the genomic patterns that underlie local adaptation under varying levels of gene flow. So we sampled silversides from these four populations in Georgia, shown in red, New York in green, Gulf of Maine in blue, and Gulf of St. Lawrence in purple. And we specifically asked, are there signatures of local adaptation that we can see on the genome? Do signatures of selection change across the climb? And how does genomic architecture vary across the climb? So to address these questions, we sampled about 50 individuals per site. We used low coverage whole genome sequencing, and so we had a final depth of about 1.4x. We don't have a reference genome for silversides, so we mapped our reads to a reference transcriptome, got about 2 million SNPs. And because these were low coverage data, all of the analyses were done happens in a probabilistic framework using genotype likelihoods. So here I'm showing the distribution of global FST across all of our SNPs, so global FST meaning across all four populations. And you can see that for most SNPs, they're hovering right around this mean global FST of 0.07, but there's this really long tail and some obvious FST outliers in the tail. And we use the program Outflank to identify about 25,000 SNPs in this high FST tail, which comprises about 1% of the total number of SNPs. So we were really interested in understanding how these SNPs were distributed across the genome. And because we don't have a reference genome for silversides, we mapped our transcriptome onto Madaka chromosomes. So silversides and Madaka share the same number of chromosomes, and Syntony has been shown to be well conserved within this group, so we figured it would make a reasonable reference to understand the chromosomal distributions of these SNPs. So I'm going to be showing a number of these types of plots. So here on the left is global FST across the four populations. And these are all the SNPs in our data set mapped to the 24 Madaka chromosomes. And this line here is the sliding mean FST. So you can see really clearly from this plot that FST outliers are not evenly distributed among chromosomes. And in fact, here I'm plotting the number above of SNPs in the top tail, and they're really concentrated on some chromosomes, with other chromosomes not having any in the tail. So then we looked at pairwise comparisons between neighboring populations. So the most striking of these pairwise comparisons was between these southern populations, Georgia versus New York, where we see the lowest level of genome-wide divergence, but the largest number of fixed SNPs. So there are thousands of fixed SNPs between these two populations. In particular, we've got thousands of them concentrated on chromosomes 18 and 24, and hundreds on chromosome 8. And when we look at what types of variants these SNPs are in the tail, we actually have enrichment for non-synonymous and UTR variants in the high FST tail, which supports selection driving this divergence on these chromosomes. So then moving northward and looking between New York and Gulf of Maine, genome-wide FST is a little higher. And these fixed SNP patterns that we saw in the previous slide are absent in this comparison, but we do see some more subtle differentiation spikes on chromosome 11, and then zooming into chromosome 11 and what variants are there, we see enrichment for non-synonymous and UTR variants in the tail here that also support selection driving this pattern. So then comparing the two most northern populations, Gulf of Maine and Gulf of St. Lawrence, we see the highest genome-wide FST, but no fixed SNPs and no really obvious signatures of divergent selection between those two populations. So going back to these the two southern populations, the fact that there are thousands of outlier SNPs that apparently stretch across the entirety of these chromosomes raises the question of whether or not they may be linked in some sort of chromosomal rearrangement, like an inversion. So unfortunately we don't have the genome yet, so we can't formally look for inversion breakpoints and that sort of thing, but we may expect inversions to show high linkage disequilibrium. So here I'm showing LD on chromosomes 8, 18, and 24, those outlier chromosomes. And so the blue colors are low linkage disequilibrium and the warm colors are high. And we actually don't see a whole lot of LD, especially on chromosomes 18 and 24. But you may remember that most of the outlier SNPs are fixed between these two populations, so there's really not a whole lot of polymorphism that we can use to measure LD. But some outside data that we have on populations reared in the lab that actually are polymorphic for the northern and southern alleles, at least on chromosome 24. They're reared in the lab for 10 generations. After 5 generations, there was really high linkage disequilibrium that spanned chromosome 24, and this LD didn't diminish after an additional 5 generations. So this suggests that recombination is being suppressed on this chromosome, perhaps due to an inversion. And then similarly, we asked, could this be some sort of inversion? And we had that same situation where we don't have a whole lot of polymorphisms in the southern populations of the northern, but we do have some polymorphism in the Gulf of Maine that we can use to look for linkage disequilibrium. And we do see some elevated linkage disequilibrium, which may signal an inversion. But we also can't rule out something else, like a selective sweep driving this LD pattern. So just to sum up, in case you were snoozing during the earlier slides, between the Gulf of Maine and Gulf of St. Lawrence, we see mostly neutral divergence and high background FST and little evidence of divergent selection. Between New York and Gulf of Maine, we see a moderate genome-wide FST, and we see different and more subtle genomic regions under selection relative to our southern populations, New York and Georgia, which show the lowest genome-wide FST, but thousands of fixed SNPs that span the length of 2 chromosomes. And so, across the decline overall, divergence patterns are different, and we have different loci under selection in different parts of this adaptive decline. And potential chromosomal rearrangements may underlie and link together these locally adaptive traits into supergene complexes. So I'd like to thank members of the Trefieldson Lab at Cornell, the Bowman Lab, the